Ramayana is one of the two major Sanskrit epics of ancient India, the other being the Mahabharata, all forming a rich Hindu itihasa. Written by the great sage Valmiki, Ramayana narrates the life of Ram, prince of the legendary kingdom of Kosala and Lord Vishnu's seventh avatar. The story of Ramayana begins with King Dashrath being the king of Ayodhya. He had three queens, Kaushalya, Sumitra, and Kaikeyi. For many years, the king had no children. On the advice of his minister and guru, sage Vasishtha, he performed a holy ceremony called the Putra Kameshti Yajna. From the holy fire came a demigod with a pot of porridge. One half of the porridge was given to Kaushalya and Kaikeyi each, and they both gave half of theirs to Sumitra. Soon, the three queens gave birth to four sons. Ram was born to Kaushalya, Bharat to Kaikeyi, Lakshman and Shatrughan to Sumitra. The princes grew up in the ashram of Guru Vasishtha. They learned the Vedas, Shastras, martial arts and archery, and returned to the palace as teenagers after completing their studies. One day, the great sage Vishwamitra visited the palace, seeking Dashrath's help. He asked for Prince Ram to be sent with him to perform Vedic rituals in his ashram without disturbance. Dashrath was not willing to endanger his beloved son Ram. But on the advice of Guru Vasishtha, Dashrath half-heartedly sent Ram and Lakshman with Vishwamitra. On their way to the ashram, Guru Vishwamitra told the princes the story of their great-grandfathers. Once near the ashram, they were attacked by Tadka and her two sons, Subahu and Marich. Ram eventually killed Tadka and Subahu, but spared Marich, throwing him to a place far away. This allowed sage Vishwamitra to complete his rituals, and they set forth on their return journey. As they were crossing a forest, the dust from Ram's feet touched a rock and turned it into a woman. She was Ahalya, who had been cursed by her husband and was waiting for many years for Ram to release her. They continued their journey and eventually entered the land of Mithila, ruled by King Janak. Janak had announced the marriage of his beautiful daughter Sita to any man who could lift and string the Shiv Dhanush, an immovable mighty bow of Lord Shiva. Many suitors tried but failed. When sage Vishwamitra asked Ram, he lifted the powerful bow effortlessly and it broke when he tried to string it. Ram thus completed the challenge and with the blessing of Guru Vishwamitra and King Janak was engaged to marry Princess Sita. King Dashrath arrived with his three queens and other two princes to Mithila. A grand wedding was arranged, with each prince marrying a beautiful princess. Ram married Sita, Lakshman married Urmila, Bharat married Mandavi, and Shatrughan married Shrutakirti. After the wedding, on their way to Ayodhya, they met the great warrior sage Lord Parshuram. Angered by the sound of the breaking Shiv Dhanush, Lord Parshuram challenged Ram to knock an arrow on his bow that was mightier than the Shiv Dhanush. Ram informed Lord Parshuram before knocking the arrow that he will have to use it to destroy something. He could either take Lord Parshuram's ability to travel anywhere or all of his accumulated tapas. He then proceeded to knock the arrow effortlessly, and Lord Parshuram agreed to part with his tapas, thus laying down his ego. He gave up his anger against all Kshatriyas, the warrior class, and went to the Himalayas to perform penance. For 12 years, they all lived happily in the palace, loved and respected by the people of Ayodhya. One day, King Dashrath noticed his hair graying. He realized it was time for Ayodhya to have a young new king. So he announced that Ram would be crowned the king the next day. Everyone was delighted and was preparing to celebrate the coronation. there was only one person unhappy, Kaikeyi's maidservant Mantra. She delivered this news to Kaikeyi, who was extremely delighted and rewarded her. But Mantra scolded Kaikeyi for being so naive. She scared Kaikeyi that she would not be the king's favorite anymore, but will become Kaushalya's servant, and that her son Bharat will not be a prince but Ram's servant. Mantra reminded her of the two boons that Dashrath had promised her when she saved his life in a battle. Kaikeyi's mind was poisoned by Mantra's words. She showed her displeasure by lying on the floor, dressed in tattered clothes. King Dashrath came to her chambers excited to share the news, but was shocked to see her in that state. He offered to do anything to please her. Kaikeyi demanded the two boons he owed her were now due. First was for Bharat to become the next king, not Ram. Second was for Ram to be exiled to the forest for 14 years. Dashrath was speechless and heartbroken. He begged Kaikeyi to ask for anything but sending Ram away. All the elders of the court tried to reason with her, but she refused to listen to anyone. When the news reached Ram, he immediately accepted it to honor his father's promise and prepared to leave for the forest. Sita and Lakshman insisted on going along as they were both very attached to him. The next day, they left to the forest, dressed as hermits, amidst all the cries and tears of the people of Ayodhya. In the forest, they met the tribal chief Guha, who was an ardent devotee of Ram. Guha took them across the river Ganga in his boat. Ram honored Guha's service and friendship by embracing him with affection. They proceeded into the forest and reached Chitrakoot, where they settled down. All this happened when Bharat and Shatrughan were at their mama or maternal uncle's house. Back in Ayodhya, King Dashrath could not bear his separation from Ram, and he fell ill and ultimately passed away. When Bharat and Shatrughan returned, Bharat was furious with his mother Kaikeyi. He learned about the events and disowned her and went to the forest with an army to bring Ram back. Bharat was guided by Guha and later sage Bharadwaj in his search for Ram. He finally reached Chitrakoot and gave Ram the news of their father's demise. He begged Ram to return to Ayodhya and rightfully ascend to the throne. But Ram refused, as that would dishonor their father's memories. He gently consoled Bharat and his mothers and advised them to return to Ayodhya. Bharat asked Ram for his sandals and carried them back on his head. He did not enter Ayodhya but stayed back in Nandigram, refusing to enter the city until Ram has returned. From there, worshipping the sandals as a symbol of Ram's presence, he governed Ayodhya as a regent. This made Ram realize that he must venture further into the forest so that people can continue with their lives. So after spending some time in Chitrakoot, Ram, Lakshman and Sita went further into the forest and reached the ashram of sage Atri and his wife Anusuya. They hosted them with affection and Anusuya gifted Sita her jewelry. From there they entered the forest of Dandaka. They were attacked by an ogre named Virad, who was once a Gandharv, a heavenly being. It was a long hard-fought battle, but finally Lakshman dug a hole in the earth and buried him, releasing him from his curse. They wandered around the lands, met many great sages, like sage Sharbhang, sage Sutikshan, and spent their time living with them. At the end of the 12th year, they went to sage Agastya's ashram, who advised them to settle down in Panchvati, near river Godavari. On their way to Panchvati, they met the gigantic vulture Jatayu, King Dashrath's good friend. They lived peacefully at Panchvati for about a year, nearly completing 13 years of their exile. One day, a demoness named Surpanakha flew near the ashram. She was captivated by Ram's beauty and immediately wanted him to be her husband. Ram politely refused, saying he already had a wife and did not want another, and asked her to check with his brother Lakshman instead. Lakshman also refused, saying he was only a servant whereas Ram was the king of Ayodhya. Seeing Sita as the barrier, Surpanakha rushed to eat her up. To teach her a lesson, Lakshman chopped off both her ears and her nose. With blood pouring all over her face, Surpanakha ran to her cousins Khar and Dushan, who came with their army to attack. Ram defeated both of them and their army effortlessly. Among the many demons who escaped was Akampana, a trusted lieutenant of Surpanakha's elder brother Ravan, the king of Lanka. Akampana informed Ravan of the two princes who insulted his sister and killed his cousins Khar and Dushan. Ravan was enraged and wanted to kill the princes immediately. Akampana, having seen their prowess, advised Ravan against an open conflict. Surpanakha further triggered Ravan's curiosity by calling Sita the most beautiful maiden on earth. Ravan formed a plan to abduct Sita and took the help of Marich, who was a survivor of the battle with Tarka and Subahu. Marich tried very hard to dissuade Ravan from committing this sin, but could not disobey his king. He took the form of a shimmering golden deer and roamed in front of Ram's cottage. Sita desired it instantly and asked Ram to bring it to her. Ram wanted to please Sita and went to catch the deer. Before going, he asked Lakshman to be careful and not leave Sita alone under any circumstance. The golden deer was very elusive and drew Ram deeper into the forest. After a long chase, Ram realized that this was unnatural and possibly a threat. So he decided to shoot the deer down. In his dying moments, Marich mimicked the voice of Ram and called out for Sita and Lakshman's help. Hearing Ram's voice, Sita got very worried and asked Lakshman to help Ram. Lakshman reminded Sita that Ram told him not to leave her alone under any circumstance. But Sita was very persuasive and instigated him. Left with no choice, Lakshman went in search for Ram, asking Sita to stay indoors. When Sita was alone, Ravan came disguised as a Brahmin. She went closer to give him alms, and he turned to his true form and abducted her by force. He escaped with her on his Pushpak Viman, a flying chariot. Jatayu, the legendary vulture they had met earlier, tried to rescue Sita when he heard her cries. But Ravan was ready for him and cut off both his wings and sent him crashing back to earth. Jatayu held on to dear life so that he can inform Ram about his beloved's abduction. Ram and Lakshman searched for Sita all around their ashram. They found some of her flowers and beads of jewels and went further in that direction. They came upon the dying Jatayu and learned that Sita was abducted by Ravan and went southwards. Ram performed the final rites of Jatayu and proceeded down south. When they were crossing Krauncha forest, they were attacked by Kabandh, a strange demon with no face and only two outstretched arms and a huge mouth. He grabbed the princess to eat them. Ram killed him and released the Gandharv, who was cursed by Lord Indra for his gluttony. Kabandh advised Ram to befriend Sugriv, a monkey prince who lived at Mount Rishimukh near Pampa. On their way, Ram and Lakshman met Shabri, who had been waiting with devotion for many years for Ram's arrival. She attained salvation for serving Ram. In desperation, Sita had wrapped all her jewelry and dropped it on a monkey, which happened to be the same Sugriv, the banished prince of Kishkindha, hoping it would reach Ram. Sugriv lived on Mount Rishimukh with a few loyal subjects. He was hiding from Bali, his elder brother and the king of Kishkindha. He was suspicious of the two warrior-looking hermits and sent his minister Hanuman to check. Disguised as a Brahmin, Hanuman tested them in conversation. Convinced that they were not Bali's spies, he invited them to meet Sugriv, Ram was impressed with Hanuman's intellect and instantly trusted him. Sugriv explained how Bali wrongly banished him from Kishkindha and stole his wife Ruma. Once Bali was fighting a demon called Mayavi, who ran inside a cave. Bali pursued him, ordering Sugriv to stand guard till he returned. About a year later, Sugriv heard a loud roar and saw blood flowing out of the cave. Assuming Bali was killed, he closed the cave with a huge boulder. He went back to Kishkindha and was crowned king. A few days later, Bali returned and decided Sugriv was a traitor and banished him from the kingdom. Seeing his sincerity, Ram promised Sugriv to eliminate Bali and make him the king again. In return, Sugriv promised to send his army of monkeys in all directions to search for Sita. Hearing Ram's story, Sugriv remembered and produced the jewels that fell on his head for identification. He then described Bali's extraordinary strength, how he uprooted an entire sal tree once, and showed him the skeleton of the demon Dundubhi that Bali had killed and flung across an entire yojana. To remove Sugriv's doubt, Ram flicked it with his big toe and sent it flying 10 yojanas. He then pierced 7 sal trees with a single arrow. On Ram's advice, Sugriv challenged Bali for a duel. In the intense hand-to-hand combat, they looked so identical that Ram could not tell them apart. Sugriv, being beaten, barely escaped and ran back to Mount Rishimukh. The next day, to solve this confusion, Lakshman made Sugriv wear a flower garland and challenge Bali again. Ram watched it from a distance and shot an arrow when he caught a clear sight of Bali. The dying Bali reproached Ram for his unjust and unprovoked attack. Ram explained that anyone who mistreated a woman behaved like an animal, and he was justified as a warrior to hunt and condemn them to death. Therefore, he acted lawfully by killing a wild monkey who forcibly stole his brother's wife. After Bali's death, Lakshman crowned Sugriv as king and Bali's son Angad as the crown prince of Kishkindha. Ram gave Sugriv time to reunite with his family while waiting for the rainy season to end. After 4 months, when the rains ended, there was still no word from Sugriv. An angry Lakshman stormed into Sugriv's palace and reminded him of his promise. Sugriv apologized profusely and sent his army in all 4 directions. Angad led the army heading south, along with Hanuman and Jambuvan, the bear chief. Since Sita was taken south, Ram thought Hanuman would be the most likely to find her and gave him his ring to reassure Sita. After searching everywhere for Sita, Angad's party was starting to despair. They were too tired, hungry, and thirsty to carry on. They entered a cave in search of water and were delighted to find plenty of food and water. The monkey spent many days there, spellbound by its beauty and comfort. Angad and Hanuman started realizing that they were entrapped there by Maya and lamented about failing Ram. Hearing their real purpose, the hermit Swayam Prabha, with her tapas power, transported them to the southernmost part of the land facing the ocean. By then, the time given to them by Sugriv had elapsed and the monkeys dreaded his wrath. Angad decided to fast till death for his failure and all the monkeys followed him. Sampati, the elder brother of Jatayu, was a wingless old vulture who was sitting nearby eagerly awaiting to feast on their dead bodies. The monkeys were discussing the events of Sita's abduction, Jatayu's heroic death and the current misery they were in. Hearing the fate of Jatayu, Sampati wept and introduced himself to the monkeys. He told them the whereabouts of Ravan's kingdom Lanka, which was 100 yojanas across the ocean from there. With his powerful eyesight, he was able to see Sita sitting forlorn in a garden, guarded by demonesses. The monkeys thanked Sampati, who sprouted new wings for his service to Ram and flew away. Angad and his group gathered with excitement to gauge which of them could jump across 100 yojanas. Some said 10, some said 20, 50 and so on. Though Angad could jump up to 90, His life could not be risked as their leader and as the crown prince of Kishkindha. Hanuman, however, did not participate but sat at a distance and watched them silently. He was cursed as a young child to forget all his powers until reminded at the right time. Jambavan revealed this to Hanuman and made him realize his true self. Recalling all his powers, Hanuman readied himself with immense confidence to leap across the ocean and find Sita. Roaring Jai Shri Ram, Hanuman took a giant leap. On his way, the mountain Mainak raised up to offer him some rest. But Hanuman politely refused as he was in a hurry. The Devas, to test his bravery and intellect, sent the Nagmata Sursa. Hanuman requested her to let him go as he was on a very important mission. But she had a boon from Brahma that anybody who crossed her path would have to enter her mouth. Hanuman thus increased his size many fold, and so Sursa kept widening her mouth. In an instant, he reduced himself to the size of a thumb and swiftly flew in and out of her mouth, thus passing the test of wits. Further on his way, a sea monster named Simhika captured his shadow and stopped his movement. She then swallowed him and he had to tear his way out of her. Finally, he landed on Lanka and observed the beautiful city from a safe distance. At night, he tried to jump his way in, but was stopped by Lankini, the protector of Lanka. In spite of his repeated request, she refused entry and slapped him, telling him that no one had ever gone past her. Losing his patience, Hanuman hit her hard with his left fist. She remembered Lord Brahma's foretelling that a day will come when she is defeated by a monkey, which is when Ravan's downfall will begin. She left Lanka, allowing Hanuman to enter. Once inside, Hanuman searched everywhere and eventually entered Ravan's palace. He saw Ravan's wife Mandodari, adorned in silk and jewels, sleeping peacefully. He wondered if that might be Sita, but immediately dismissed it, certain that Sita would not be enjoying comforts in captivity. Eventually, he reached Ashok Vatika and saw a beautiful woman sitting forlorn in worn-out clothes. Confident that he found Sita, he hid in a tree to wait and learn more. At dawn, Ravan visited Sita and once again tried convincing her to be his wife. When Sita continued to rebuke him for his misdeeds, he was enraged and gave her 2 months to consent, failing which he would eat her for breakfast. By Ravan's orders, the demonesses guarding Ashok Vatika used all means to scare and convince her. One of them, named Trijada, drove them away and protected Sita, reassuring her that Ram will rescue her. After witnessing these events, Hanuman worried that his sudden appearance might scare Sita, so he recited the story of Ram, still hidden, and then revealed himself. Sita still feared that this was another one of Ravan's tricks. So to earn her trust fully, he narrated Ram's story in more detail, starting from his birth, wedding, exile, and Sita's abduction. He further explained Ram's friendship with Sugriv and the events that had followed up until the moment he met her. He then gave her Ram's ring as final proof. Sita was overwhelmed. He offered to take her back to Ram on his shoulders, but Sita refused. She believed that only Ram himself can rescue and redeem her. To reassure Ram that Hanuman met her, she told him a story that only Ram and her knew. She also gave him her last remaining jewel, her Chudamani, which is a hairpin. Before leaving, to send a warning message to Ravan, Hanuman started creating chaos in the garden. When the demons reported the trouble caused by a powerful monkey, Ravan sent 80,000 Kinkaras, followed by Jambumali and 5 other generals. Hanuman killed them all, including Ravan's own son, Akshakumar. Getting desperate to resolve the situation, Ravan's eldest and most prolific son, Indrajit, used Brahmastra on Hanuman. Though Hanuman had a boon that he was impervious to it, he agreed to be politely bound by it. The demons tied him up, and he remained bound because he was eager to meet Ravan himself. In Ravan's court, he introduced himself as the envoy of King Sugriv and Ram, and advised Ravan to release Sita to save himself from Ram's fury. Enraged, Ravan ordered Hanuman's execution. But his wise younger brother, Vibhishan, stopped him as it was unethical to kill an envoy. Instead, he advised to send Hanuman back injured. So Ravan ordered to set his tail on fire. When this news reached Sita, she prayed to Agnidev, the god of fire, to protect Hanuman. Surprised that the fire did not hurt him, Hanuman took advantage of the situation and flew all around Lanka and set the whole city ablaze with his tail. He returned to Ashok Vatika to ensure Sita was unaffected by the fire. With her blessing, Hanuman leapt back across the ocean, touching Mount Mainak on his way. He landed with a jubilant roar and recounted all the events to Angad and his group. They wanted to declare war against Lanka, rescue Sita and go back to Ram with her. But Jambavan dissuaded them not to act without Ram's orders. They headed back to Kishkindha and stopped at Madhuvan, a place full of honey and fruits. Dadimukh, Sugriv's uncle, who guarded that place, tried to stop them, but was driven away by them. When he complained, Sugriv deduced that the mission must have been a success. Realizing their service to Ram, Dadimukh apologized to Angad and escorted them all to Sugriv's court. At Mount Prasavna, Hanuman informed Ram that Sita had been found, narrated all the events, and gave him Sita's Chudamani. Ram was elated to hear that Sita was safe and proceeded towards Lanka, reaching the ocean shore. Back in Lanka, Ravan called for counsel after seeing the damage caused by Hanuman. His aides encouraged him to battle and assured him victory. They even advised him to force Sita to be his wife. But Ravan had been cursed by Lord Brahma to instantly explode if he forced himself on any woman. Only Vibhishan, his youngest brother, warned him of the ill omens marking his failure and advised him to return Sita. When Ravan called him a traitor, Vibhishan refused to abet his crime and left Lanka. He crossed the ocean and asked Ram for refuge. Ram consulted his leaders, who had mixed opinions, but Hanuman strongly supported it. So Ram welcomed Vibhishan, who then described the strength of Ravan's army in great detail. Ram prayed to Samudra Raj, the lord of the ocean, to appeal for a way to cross it. Ram waited patiently for 3 days, but got no response. In his anger, Ram knocked an arrow to dry up the entire ocean. Immediately, Samudra Raj appeared and pleaded for mercy. He then told Ram that Nal, the son of Vishwakarma, and Neel, the son of Agnidev, have a unique curse that anything they throw in water will not sink. This, along with Nal's architecture skills, would help build a bridge to Lanka. As the knocked arrow had to be released, Samudra Raj advised Ram to aim it towards a group of people destroying nature. Nal, Neel and the army worked fast and completed the bridge in 5 days. Meanwhile, Ravan sent many spies who were caught by Vibhishan and driven away. They kept giving regular reports to Ravan of Ram's army marching towards the shore of Lanka. Ram arrived at Lanka and halted at Mount Suvena for the night. From there, Sugriv saw Ravan standing on the palace wall and leapt to fight him. He threw down Ravan's crown and returned to the camp. Ram disapproved of his act that did not befit a king. Ram sent Angad as an envoy to give Ravan the last chance to release Sita. But Angad was ill-treated and attacked. He escaped and returned after destroying the top of Ravan's palace. With all avenues for peace exhausted, the deadly battle began. Ravan's army suffered many initial losses, so he sent his son Indrajit to battle. He used magic and bound Ram and Lakshman with a net of serpents. Sugriv's army began to despair, but Lord Garuda, the king of birds, appeared and scared the serpents away. His touch instantly healed them. Ram and Lakshman continued to rain powerful arrows on Ravan's army and destroying all his formations and tactics. Ravan sent his generals from all sides to attack, but were defeated by Hanuman, Sugriv, Angad and their units. After losing most of his generals, Ravan entered the battle himself. He fought against many and finally faced Ram. He was defeated by Ram and fell on the ground without his chariot or any weapons. Ram spared his life and shamed him by asking him to return with weapons to have a fair fight. Ravan returned to the palace and ordered his soldiers to wake his brother Kumbhakaran. He had a boon from Lord Brahma to sleep for 6 months at a time. The soldiers tried various ways to wake him and finally succeeded with lots of food. Kumbhakaran disapproved of Ravan's act that had led to Lanka's destruction, but swore his loyalty to Ravan. He went to battle and terrorized Ram's army, causing heavy damage. Ram fought a long, hard battle with him, finally defeating him by disarming him limb by limb. Ravan despaired at his losses and sent Indrajit once again. Indrajit used Brahmastra and rendered the entire army unconscious, including Ram and Lakshman. Only Hanuman, Jambuvan and Vibhishan remained unaffected. On Jambuvan's advice, Hanuman flew to Mount Rishaba to get a healing herb called Mrita Sanjeevani. Since he was unable to find the right plant, he plucked the entire mountain and brought it to the battleground. The smell of the herb healed everyone. Thus the battle continued, and Ram and Lakshman killed many more powerful demons, including the sons of Ravan and Kumbhakaran. Indrajit entered the battle once again. Using magic, he created an illusion of killing Sita. Ram fainted on hearing the news, but Vibhishan assured that it was not real. Lakshman went to the sanctuary of Nikumbila, where Indrajit was performing a ritual that would make him invincible. A fierce battle ensued between them, but Lakshman finally emerged victorious. Heartbroken at Indrajit's death, Ravan entered the battle once again and fought Ram and Lakshman directly. Seeing Vibhishan at Ram's side, Ravan was infuriated and attacked him. Lakshman saved Vibhishan's life, but got critically injured. Ram wanted to abandon the war and die too, but once again Hanuman brought Sanjeevani and revived Lakshman. The battle was being watched by all the gods, devas and great sages, including sage Agastya. Sensing Ram's tiredness, Agastya taught Ram the Aditya Hridayam mantra in praise of the sun god, advising him to keep repeating it to triumph over his enemies in battle. To help Ram fight on equal grounds, Indra gave him his chariot. Ram and Ravan fought for 7 continuous days. As Ravan had 10 heads, every time Ram got one of them, another one would appear. After an incomparably hard battle, Ram used the Brahmastra given to him by sage Agastya and killed Ravan, ending the battle. As promised, Vibhishan was crowned the king of Lanka. Ram sent Hanuman to give Sita the news of his victory. Sita was overjoyed and prepared to meet him. But when Ram saw Sita, though he was filled with joy, he remained calm and told her that he rescued her out of duty as a prince of Ayodhya. He felt that her forced captivity had brought dishonor on his dynasty. Shattered by the doubt cast on her, Sita declared that she will jump into a pyre and kill herself. Such was her purity and loyalty to Ram that she walked out unaffected. Ram happily accepted her and reassured her that he did not doubt her, but wanted to prove it to the whole world. All the gods watching blessed them. Indra and Dashrath appeared and offered Ram a boon each. Ram asked Indra to bring back to life every single monkey that fought for him in the war. He asked his father to forgive Kekai and Bharat and embrace them in the family again. They all boarded a flying chariot and journeyed towards Ayodhya. On the way, Ram showed Sita all the places and recounted all the events. He sent Hanuman ahead to inform Bharat of his return, since Bharat had resolved to give up his life if Ram did not return exactly at the end of 14 years. Bharat was ecstatic and eagerly awaited Ram's arrival. Ram landed at Nandigram and rejoiced his reunion with Bharat and family. The very next day, Ram was crowned the king of Ayodhya, bringing peace and prosperity to all the 3 worlds.